When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." So the idea of the porch isn't literal. I mean, it's much more like a place where you gather with family, with friends, just an informal place. You can talk about important stuff or fun stuff or any kind of stuff. So the word from the porch is where we just get together and talk about God's word together. Just the other day, we took a couple of our grandkids to a store called Five Below. Maybe you've heard of it. It's a store, I think, that was designed to give kids a place to spend their allowance, because almost everything in the store is $5 or less. There's a few things, 10 bucks, but most of it is $5 or less. And it's like, here's a place you can go and get instant gratification for your allowance money. And our kids just love it. And it doesn't matter that the stuff is cheap, and it doesn't matter that it breaks sometimes within a few hours of when you get it, because the store is right there, and you get your next allowance money, you can go spend it. And it's something that's kind of bred into us from the moment we are born, I think, in this culture, is this kind of hunger, this need to want to get the next thing. And for us as grown-ups, of course, you know, once we get more mature, we handle this quite differently, of course, than our kids do. Our need for new things is satisfied a little longer. You know, sometimes for days or weeks after we buy something new, we're pretty satisfied with it. In fact, for me, with cars, it's usually about 2 years that I can be satisfied with it. But then that same hunger keeps coming back. And in our text for today, Jesus is talking about that hunger. Although in this case, it was a literal physical hunger. The people just before this, in the scriptures, there had been the feeding of the 5,000, and Jesus, had presided over a scenario in which 5,000 people who came to this wilderness place were all fed and had their fill. And so when Jesus got to the other side of the lake, some of these folks had followed him, and they were kind of nagging him, really, in our text for today, saying, "So, how about that bread?" And you know, it's hard for us to grasp, those of us who live in a pretty wealthy culture, it's hard for us to grasp
this kind of physical nagging concern, this hunger that you don't know where your next meal is going to come from, and this fear that you might actually have to be without food for a long and dangerous period of time. Although, sadly, even in this wealthy nation of ours, there are people who have to deal with that. Most of us who'll be watching this video don't have any idea what that's really like, but it is possible that the people who are nagging Jesus for food were doing so because they thought it would be a pretty good idea to follow somebody around who could make sure they were always fed. We don't know exactly why, but I think Jesus' message to them and to us is the same. As they came to him and said, "How about some more bread?" And Jesus said to them and to us, the problem isn't your hunger, it's that you're seeking satisfaction in the wrong place. And then he went on to say something really mysterious. He said, "I am the bread of life. If anyone comes to me, they'll never be hungry. If anyone believes in me, they'll never be thirsty." And I have to admit, when I hear that kind of thing, at first, it just seems so heavenly-minded that it's no earthly good. I mean, what am I supposed to do with that? What does that even mean? If there's somebody who is genuinely hungry, what do they do with Jesus telling them that he's the bread of life, that they'll never be hungry again if they come to him? And, you know, even my grandson, Christopher, what is he supposed to do with that? I mean, when he goes to Five Below, he comes out with something concrete. He comes out with a high-volume squirt rifle with which he can win water fights, at least for a couple of hours until it breaks. And when I go to my car dealership after a couple of years, I come away with a vehicle with that new car smell, and it lasts sometimes for months. And, you know, my friends and colleagues will ooh and ah over my new car for at least a couple of weeks. There's something I can see, something I can hold on to. What do I do with this promise that Jesus gives, that he is the bread of life? If I come to him, I'll never be hungry. If I believe in him, I'll never be thirsty. What does that even mean? But I think the key is in exactly the way he said it. Jesus said to those who are around him and through the scripture to us, those who come to him will never be hungry. And I think what that says to me is that our hunger isn't really the problem. You know, God designed us to be hungry like any other creature. You know, physically we have to be hungry or else we would die. We wouldn't get fuel for our bodies. But what makes us different from the animals is that we also have designed into us by God spiritual hunger. And of course, the business world figured this out a long time ago. That's why everywhere you turn, there are people saying to you, "You know that hunger you feel inside? I can take care of that. This new car, this new squirt gun, this new whatever, that's just what you're looking for. It's going to feed that spiritual hunger." And the tricky thing is, they're not exactly lying, because it does kind of satisfy you for a little bit until the thing breaks or until you get tired of it. And then, of course, you go back for more, which is how they keep selling us stuff. But in our text for today, the clue is Jesus saying, come to me when you feel this longing. Come to me when you feel this hunger. If you come to me, then you'll never be hungry again. If you get in that habit of coming to me, and if you believe in me, you will never be thirsty. So this is the key, and this is the change that I realize I need to make in my life, because I have to admit this is going to be a long and difficult struggle for me, because I am conditioned after 2 years, you know, when I'm kind of tired of having the same old vehicle and I get that feeling inside, that hunger, I'm conditioned to just go to the dealer, you know? Whatever it is, whether it's a car or boredom or anything else, what Jesus says is when we feel that spiritual hunger, it's important for us to learn to come to Him first, to seek Him out first, to turn to Him in prayer, to turn to Him going for a walk, to turn to Him reflecting on the Scriptures, to ask the Holy Spirit to speak to us as we turn to Him, to go there first. And I think what Jesus is saying in this text is when we do that, we will realize the true nature of our hunger, and He will satisfy us. And the second thing He says is really important too. If you believe in Me, the one who believes in Me will never be thirsty, kind of continuing the metaphor. And that's important too, because honestly, to look at a brand new car or a relationship with somebody that I can't see, faith is important. To trust that Christ is real, that He will meet us, and that as we believe in Him, as we trust in Him, as we walk with Him, as we listen to Him, the true need that we have for a relationship with God will be revealed. And over time, we will learn that Christ is the only one. You know, our relationship with God is the only thing that can satisfy that hunger that is inside of us. Whether I need or get a new car isn't really the issue. Whether my grandson gets a squirt gun or not with his allowance money isn't the real issue. The real issue in our text for today is seeing and being aware that what we are facing with these longings can never be satisfied by stuff. It's a spiritual hunger. It's a need for our relationship with God. And my prayer for myself and for you is that over time, and it is going to take a long time for me, because I have to admit, many times a day, I think if I just get this one more thing, I'll have what I need. But over time, my prayer is that our habits will change, that by that gift of faith that we can ask for and receive from God, we will learn to trust in Christ, learn to turn to Him, change our habits, so that when we feel that longing, the first thing we do isn't to just go out and buy something to try and fill the void. But we will turn to Christ and walk with Christ. And yeah, we may still get something that we need or something that we want, and that's fine, but we won't do it because we think it's going to meet our need. Because it won't. At least not for very long. So let's realize what this hunger is inside, and who is the only one that can meet it.